First of all, if you don't have a purpose, let's say, it isn't that your life becomes neutral in a meaningless sense. It's that your life becomes characterized by unbearable suffering, because the baseline condition of life is something like unbearable suffering. And what you have to set against that is a noble and worthwhile purpose. And hopefully your determination of that purpose is buttressed to some degree by the wisdom of the past, because you can't conjure something like that up on your own. And if you provide people with nobility of purpose, then they can tolerate the suffering of existence without becoming entirely corrupted by it. And cultures that don't do that, it isn't even so much that they die, it's that cultures that don't do that are dead. They're done. They don't have a story anymore. And they don't have a call to adventure. And then, well, then everyone suffers stupidly as a consequence. It's a very bad thing. So Churchill made the same observation that many of the great psychologists and philosophers made in the early part of the 20th century. It's like, bring the story forward and propagate it and make it the most noble possible story, and then you motivate people to transcend themselves, which they need to do. So, yes, he's exactly right in his diagnosis.
Just to stay with him for a moment, he's painted as the great defender of freedom. It's possible that your country, Canada, and certainly my country, Australia, would have not continued as free societies had it not been for that man courageously standing at a time when so few did. He wasn't the inventor of freedom. Freedom as we understand it, and I want to unpack that a bit, something very, very few people in very few cultures down through the ages and even today have ever really experienced.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, yes, and partly because we're afraid of it, I would say. I mean, people think of freedom as the ability to implement your whim. And freedom opens up that as a possibility. But sustainable freedom, that isn't what it's about at all. It's primarily about responsibility. It's about determining which load you're going to pick up and carry. That's the proper definition of appropriate freedom. It's not dim gratification of instantaneous impulse. It's self-evident that that doesn't work. Two-year-olds do that, and that's why they can't live in the world. They can't organize themselves across time. They can't sacrifice the moment for the future. And the more sophisticated you get, I suppose, in some sense, the more you're able to do that. And then your freedom becomes the freedom to choose the proper responsibility. And that's also not something that we've been good at communicating to young people. If we talk to them about responsibility, we generally do it in a finger-wagging sort of way. It's like, well, you're breaking the rules, you're a bad person. And well, that may be true because people break the rules and there's no shortage of badness in people. But the proper message for young people is to say, well, no, you don't understand. You want to take on responsibility. You want to take on the heaviest load that you can conceive of that you might be able to move, because it gives your life nobility and purpose. And that offsets the tragedy. And not only psychologically, not only does it offset it psychologically because you have a purpose and something to wake up for, right, and to face the difficulties of the day, but also because if you face the difficulties of the day properly, you actually ameliorate suffering, not only in the psychological sense, but because you make the world at least a less terrible place. And that's something, right? To move things away from hell is something, even if you're not, you know, self-evidently moving forthrightly to heaven. To move things away from the worst they can be is, well, that's a noble goal in and of itself. You know, I'm a real admirer of the work of Jean Piaget, and Piaget is a developmental psychologist, and few people know, the world's most well-known developmental psychologist, and few people know that he was actually motivated in his intellectual pursuits by the desire to reconcile science with religion. That was what his driving force from the time that he was a young man. You wouldn't know that even necessarily by reading his writings, because it's implicit rather than explicit in them. But he has a different model of what constitutes morality than Freud. Freud's model is combative. It's sort of the superego as tyrant. So the superego would be the strictures of society, the id, the biological impulses, and the ego crushed between those, right? So the ego is this thing that's crushed between nature and culture. And so it's a tense and combative model of the human psyche. And there's something about it that's accurate, because some of the restrictions that are put on your impulse gratification are imposed on you, in a sense, tyrannically. Mm. But Piaget's perspective was much more optimistic, and I think much more accurate. he noticed that as children organized themselves spontaneously as they developed, especially within the confines of their own spontaneous play, they didn't so much subsume or inhibit their dark and aggressive impulses as make them sophisticated and transform them into universally acceptable games. So for Piaget, a game that a group of children were playing, that all of them were playing voluntarily and that was going well and that they all wanted to continue playing, was a microcosm of society, and literally a microcosm of society. The reason the children were playing those games was to practice being productive members of society. And he felt that the appropriate game tended towards what he described as an equilibrated state. So an equilibrated state would be a game that you'll play because you've decided it's a good game, but that you can play with others because they've also decided that it's a good game. And so that can work at the individual level and at the familial level and at the social level. And if you get all those things working simultaneously, then you have a sustainable enterprise. And it's predicated not so much on the inhibition of impulse or on the regulation of it, but of the integration of impulses into a pattern of being that gratifies them on a relatively permanent basis. So, you know, if you want to go to university and become a physician, I think there's a lot of sacrifice of impulsive gratification that goes along with that. But if you become a physician, then it's a noble enterprise, people support you socially, and all of the needs that you need to have fulfilled will also be fulfilled by that enterprise. Well, that's a way better model. And so it's strange that the maximum freedom comes with the adoption of a discipline and then also the adoption of responsibility. That frees you up and everyone else around you in the long run. And if you explain that to people, especially in this day and age when they've been fed a never-ending diet of idiot rights and freedoms, they're immediately on board with it because they know. Mm. They know that most of the meaning that people experience in their life is a consequence of adopting responsibility.